Recently, I've been hit with a number of articles talking about some cultural changes that people are seeking to make to scripture and to theological discussions, which concerns me. And I want to address that today in a bit of a detour from our discussion in James, though an important one to that all the same. Stay tuned. This recent shift that I've seen it for some time now, but I've been inundated, as I said, with some articles recently and felt it important to speak on the matter. There's been a culturally, as you know, in our school systems and various other places, this push, this shift for what they call non-binary language or the use of they to describe people rather than gender language like him or her. That push has been then now taken, or is being taken, attempted anyway, toward theological discussions and toward scripture. A number of people, I would say, quote unquote, and I use the term loosely, Christian people pushing for this shift within the scriptures, even a change of language from him referencing God to now they to reference God as a manner of being culturally sensitive to those that would identify in that particular group. And really, I think it's a push from this what I would categorize as the LGBTQIA+ agenda. Now, as I mentioned that, and who knows, maybe I'll get pulled off of YouTube for this. I have nothing against such people. I understand that there are many deep-seated hurts and scars in those people's lives, that there are, just as all of us, that we deal with struggles with sin, very real struggles, struggles really that we need the help of the Spirit, we need the salvation through Christ to be able to overcome. And so we are to approach those dealing with these things with compassion and with grace and with truth that has been tempered with love. Not being afraid to speak up, right? But at the same time, not being harsh as we have seen some others be. Why is my concern about this? So, and this isn't just a vlog to express an opinion, all right? I know that many times people just jump on the bandwagon. There's a new event going on or a new thought or idea, and I jump on because I have to get my opinion out. This is not my opinion. This is what Scripture says. This is what it tells us. This is why I'm concerned. The fundamental issue, or the foundational issue, if you will, is the inspiration of Scripture. Because in changing the pronouns, even, is an attack on this very important doctrine and something that God has been pretty clear about within the Scripture. Remember, Scripture as a whole, the Bible, is God's revelation to us. He is telling us who He is, not us determining who He is. He's telling us, this is who I am. And what is it? Just a few quick thoughts. This is probably review for you on the inspiration, but inspiration hits a number of levels, and we could categorize it as this: as plenary. We believe in the plenary verbal inspiration of Scripture. In other words, we believe in the words, and the Scriptures as a whole are inspired. And defining that down, or breaking that down even further, 2 Timothy chapter 3 verses 16 to 17. Every Scripture, from the first page to the last, is inspired by God and useful. In other words, it's God-breathed. It is from Him, and it is useful specifically for His purposes, teaching, reproof, correction, and training in righteousness. Goal, that the person dedicated to whom? To God, may be equipped for every good work. The writings themselves are inspired. We could go to 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 20 to 21 as well. Above all, you do well to recognize no prophecy of Scripture ever comes by the prophet's own imagination. No prophecy was ever born by human impulse. Rather, men carried along by the Holy Spirit spoke from God. The The illustration there, if you've heard me talk about this before, is wind in a ship's sail, blowing it along. The words themselves, Exodus 24:4. Moses wrote down all the words of the Lord. You go to Deuteronomy 18 to 19 as well. The tenses, Matthew 22, 31 to 32, the fact that it says, I am, is Jesus talking there. The tense itself is important, referencing that God is the eternal existing one, thus he is the God of the living. And Matthew 5, verses 17 to 18. Talking about that, then until I tell you the truth, verse 18, until heaven and earth pass away, not the smallest letter or stroke of a letter from the law will pass from the law until everything takes place. Jesus talking that even the smallest letter in Hebrew, or that's what he's referencing at that point, and the stroke of a letter, none of that will pass away until from the law until everything takes place. So even down to the very strokes of the letters themselves are inspired, are from God, directed by him. I was reading this article, noting a few things, and I wanted to share that with you today as we're talking about this. Of course, the scripture uses the masculine language for God. It's not engendering God in that respect. It's not saying God is a man, although Jesus took on what, human form, all right? He does have that now. It's not engendering his essence necessarily or his being, but this is how God has chosen to reveal himself. And in masculine terms as well, the words father and son, which in our own mind imply specific concepts, and with that ideas, right? About what a father is, what a son is. Now, I understand that in our experiences, sometimes those things are tainted in a negatively so. So we have a false concept of who God is. But in the purest possible form, this is who he is. The article says we can no more replace the masculine pronoun in reference to God than we can replace the terms father and son. Unilaterally substituting these words and the ideas behind them would have significant impact on our understanding of God's eternal being. We cannot separate the personal content of God's self-revelation from the linguistical form of the biblical text. We are not the lords of theological language. God alone is, for through it he saw fit to reveal himself. And so this push, why am I so concerned about it? More so, it's if we destroy the inspiration of Scripture, then we destroy everything else. Theological doctrine is so often interconnected with each other. You get rid of the inspiration of Scripture, then we get rid of the fact that, well, is God really the only God? Or is he just one of many, like the Greeks used to believe? Is Jesus really the only way? Can I have salvation another way, right? Was his sacrifice then worthless? Am I really even evil? You know, I think I'm pretty good in comparison to other people. I don't think I was born into sin. I don't really need salvation. I can make it on my own. You see, and that's just the beginning. It goes into the areas of science. It goes into the family and relationships. It begins to make everything fall apart. And the reality is we do need the truth of the Scripture. Without inspiration, the Scripture itself may just be a lie, maybe a collection of fairy tales. And we end up then defining God in our terms. We make him in our image, rather than we ourselves purposefully trying and seeking, as Paul says in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 1 and 2, to imitate God, to imitate the love, to imitate and other various other passages of Scripture, his character in its entirety. We're supposed to seek to reflect him. And while not specifically made of wood, stone, or metal, this kind of ideology, along with others, is really a push for us to recraft and reshape God philosophically, theologically, mentally into something that he's not. Scripture must be our final authority about who God is, rather than allowing culture to define it for us. The article continued saying, God has revealed himself through the words of Scripture. Even as our contemporary language shifts, Christians should look at the unchanged nature of God's word so that we might behold him as he is. In 2 Peter chapter 3, I'll conclude with this verse today. I realize this vlog's a little longer. Verses 2 Peter 3:15 to 18, it says this, "And regard the patience of the Lord as salvation, just as also our dear brother Paul wrote to you according to the wisdom given to him, speaking of these things in all his letters." Some things in these letters are hard to understand, things the ignorant and unstable twist to their own destruction as they do the rest of Scripture. There's a pattern here. Therefore, he concludes the end of the book. This is an important benediction. "Therefore, dear friends, since you have been forewarned, be on your guard that you do not get led astray by the error of these unprincipled men and fall from your firm grasp on the truth. Rather, grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and on that eternal day." And God's people said, amen. Thanks for joining us today. We'll pick it up next week as we continue through James. Until then, God bless.